tired of doing all this digging stuff. I don't know about... Oh, hey guys, welcome back to Kid City. It's great to see you. Don't mind me, I was just doing some digging outside, you know, digging me some ditches. I'm sure you're wondering why, but don't worry, we'll get into that later today. Okay, for now, worship, there we go. It's time for worship, so everybody come on, get up out of your seats, get your hands up, your hands out, some room to worship, and let's get started. Come on, let's go. Learned about how he became a prophet, how he followed Elijah, learned how to be a great follower, and was rewarded by learning how to be a great leader from it. And now Elijah's gone and he's the new leader of the prophets. So we're going to be continuing his story, and it's a doozy. I'm telling you, some awesome stuff is happening here. So let me kind of clue you guys into this Bible story. So we're in the book of 2 Kings, and now we're in chapter 3. And in this story, you have this king over Israel. Now, some context, we have Israel, and we have Judah. They're both God's people, but they split as a nation. So now we have two nations, and then we have this third country called Edom, and then we have a fourth country. So, okay, so let me get you guys going here. So the king of Israel, they were known for not being good guys. They didn't love God. They worshipped false gods and idols. It was a whole big mess. But he, as a king, had another country called Moab, and they were basically serving them. They would send them sheep and goats and all kinds of stuff. to kind of like a tax almost. And all of a sudden, this country rebels against him. Like, nope, we're not giving you no more sheep, no more goats. We don't want to do that anymore. And he's like, well, I can't just let that happen. I'm a king. I have to show that I'll keep my people under control, right? So he's like, okay, let me go to Judah, talk to their king, go to Edom, talk to their king, and we'll join forces, and then we'll go down to Moab, and we'll show them what they're supposed to be doing, and take back their stuff. And they decide, okay, but they're pretty strong, and they got some good fortresses and stuff, like, in front of them toward us. So we'll sneak around the back. That's what we'll do. So they take their whole army, and they go out into the desert, and they come around the back of the country. Now, this seemed like a great idea. But what's the problem with being out in the desert? Yeah, there's no water and stuff, right? And they got this whole three armies of people walking for 7 days through the desert. They ran out of water, and there was no water around for them. So what were they going to do? Well, they're like, uh-oh, maybe God brought us out here to die, right? Like, or to, by the time we show up and try to fight Moab, Moab's going to be like, we've been drinking water and hanging out the last few days. You've been marching through a desert with no water for 7 days. I think we're going to win, right? But, of course, the king of Judah, he loved God and he served God. So he said, I don't know if this is a hopeless situation. Isn't there a prophet around here that we can talk to? Oh, hey, Elisha's nearby. So they go to talk to Elisha, the powerful prophet of God, right? And he doesn't like this king of Israel. He knows he doesn't love God or serve God. And he's like, dude, if this guy, Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, was not here, I would not even be talking to you. But for the sake of God's people, I will help you. And so he prays to God. And he says, okay, here's what God wants you to do. Start digging some ditches. Okay, wait, we're hot, and we're thirsty, and we have no water, and you want us to do some more hot, thirsty work and dig some ditches? Well, that doesn't make any sense. How's that going to help us get water, right? But he's like, hey, have faith. God knows what he's doing. Dig some ditches. And when they did that, God was going to fill them with water without using a rainstorm or anything like that, right? And so they're like, okay, well, we're hot and we're thirsty, but we're going to obey God. We're going to follow these orders. We're going to see what happens. So they take both all three armies, and they say, let's dig some ditches, right? And so overnight, just as God said, a flood comes out down from the mountains that were nearby. So a rainstorm that was nowhere near them. And this is important because now Moab has no idea that water is coming around anywhere. So water floods down and fills up all the ditches, and now they have water to drink, right? But here's the cool thing. The reason God let this happen the way it did was not just to show that he would provide for them to give them water for what they needed. He was also doing it to get them the victory in the battle. Because here's what happens. Moab wakes up in the morning and they're looking out over the fields where the other armies are. And what did they see? Well, you would think they would see ditches full of water, but it was early in the morning and the sun had just risen. And do you know what the sun rising sometimes looks like? It's red, right? And you got all this red light on all this water that wasn't there before. You know what they thought it was? They thought it was blood. Why would there be so much blood? Ooh, maybe the armies fought each other, but three different countries together, right? Maybe they got in a big fight and they killed each other. And now all their stuff is just laying there and we didn't have to fight for it. So Moab thinks this. God let them get tricked into thinking this. So they go rushing over there to get what they think is a bunch of treasure. And you know what they find? Three armies rested, no longer thirsty. They drank the water that they needed and they're ready for this ambush. And so the entire Moab army is completely defeated. Because God provided the water, but also the path for victory. And because they obeyed God, they were able to receive that victory. That's our Bible story for today, guys. It's an amazing story. We're going to dig into what we can learn from it in just a minute here. Wow, that was an awesome Bible story. And there's so much we can learn from it, right? So let me ask you this. When you go to McDonald's, right, you pull up to the drive-thru, and what do they say through the little speaker? That's right. They say, can I take your order? And then you go to Walmart. let's say, Walmart or Target, and you go there, and what does it say on the back of their little vest? How can I help you, right? And when you fall down and you hurt yourself and you run to your mom or dad, what do they say? What's wrong? So what does all these things have in common? They're trying to get what you need from you. They want to know, what is it you need? If they're going to help you, they need to know what kind of help you need, right? Otherwise, they're not going to know what to do. Do you want a cheeseburger or a hamburger or fries or a basket of puppies? Because if that's what you want, you're in the wrong place if you're talking to McDonald's, right? And if you're asking them something, you're looking confused and you're just like, I don't know. They know you need something, right? So they're going to find out what you need so they can help you. And then if you get hurt and you run to mom and dad, they need to know, okay, well, do you just need like a kiss and you're all better? Do you need a band-aid? Maybe you're bleeding a little bit. Is your bone sticking out and we got to take you to the hospital, right? They need to know what kind of aid you need. With God, it's the same thing. When we need his help, what do? We ask for it. Admit that you need something, that you need help. Now, you might be thinking, wait, well, this is God we're talking about, right? Doesn't he already know what I'm thinking, what I need, what's going on in my life? Why do I need to ask him? Well, he does know, of course, what's going on in your life, and he does know what you need, but you're his children, right? And parents want to hear from their children. They don't want to just provide food for them and provide stuff and then never talk to them. It's a relationship, so he wants to hear from you. He wants you to come to him and ask him for that help. Because here's the thing, the going to God and asking for help, it's a sign of our faith. It's, Lord, not only do I know you provide for me, I also know you hear me. I also know you care about me. I also know you will take time to listen to me. You won't just, oh no, I'm God, I'm too busy, your problem is too little. He wants you to come to him. He delights in blessing his children. So admit that you need help. Okay, remember in the story, the kings had a really big need. They were stranded in the desert with no water. That's a really bad place to be. You could die from that, right? And there's definitely no way you're about to win a big battle if you're 7 days thirsty in the desert. They didn't have a water bottle. They didn't have a pool nearby. They couldn't bring all the water with them on camels or something. It was too much for them to handle on their own. They had no way to get out of this, so they needed God's help. They needed his help because nobody else in the world was going to be able to make this happen for them. And of course, we learn from the story, God always helps us in ways, one, we don't really expect. Two, he answers needs we didn't even know we needed to ask for. Remember, they didn't actually just need water. They needed the victory. Now, they thought they were going to do it the normal way. Just fight, and we'll see what happens. But God's like, no, I got a better idea. How about we trick them with pools of water and the sunlight from the sunrise, and then beating them will be no problem whatsoever. We won't just win, we will have an amazing victory over them. That sounds like a better plan to me, but I never would have thought to ask God for it. I might have, help us win the battle, amen, but that might have been it. I had no idea that God could have come up with something as clever as that. So what is that second thing we need to know? We need to admit our needs to God, but then we have to have enough faith to do what? Do what God says, even if it doesn't make any sense. Because that's the kind of God he is. He knows everything in the universe, right? Is there a good chance he knows more than we do? Yeah, it's a really good chance. Is there a good chance he's got some better plans than us? I'm pretty sure that's the case, right? So when you ask him, when you admit your need to him, and he gives you instructions, follow those instructions, even if they don't make any sense. I mean, the biggest miracle of all, Jesus dying on the cross for us and coming back to life for Easter, that didn't make sense to people. They're like, he's the Messiah? He's dead. How can a dead Messiah save us? That's crazy. You're crazy. That's a really weird way to save the world. But it was God's plan, right? And of course it worked. Hey, Jesus came back from the dead and we have a relationship with God now. Our sins are forgiven. All we have to do is follow his instructions. I mean, let's look at some of the other miracles Jesus did. He had 5,000 people or more in front of him who needed food. What was he going to do? Send them into the town to buy it? I mean, I don't even know if they had enough money for that kind of stuff, right? And that would have taken a really long time. Oh, okay. Let's take 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes, and we'll feed 5,000 people. What? That doesn't make any sense. Of course not, but when you follow his instructions, you have enough food for more than 5,000 people, and it's even have 12 baskets left over, right? Just because it doesn't make sense doesn't mean God's not working, and doesn't mean it's not going to happen, right? It seemed crazy, but God works in mysterious ways, and he's faithful. He says, if you follow my instructions, if you're faithful to me, I will bless you. Seems like an open and shut case to me, right? So God said, dig some ditches. What are you going to do? Go dig some ditches, right? And what happens? You admit your need. You follow God's instructions, even when they don't make sense. And then you receive the blessings, God's blessings. He loves to bless his children. When you're faithful and obey, he will bless you. He takes care of your needs. He's, one of his names is Jehovah Jireh, and that means God, my provider. He sees what you need. He knows what you need. He knows what's best for you. He even knows the stuff you won't even think to ask for, and he will take care of us. He didn't just give them water. He gave them victory, and it's the same for us. So what are we going to do when we pray? Lord, these are my needs that I can think of. Whatever needs I can't think of, you know what they are. Please help me to follow your instructions even when they don't make sense. So for example, some of you might be going through a hard time right now, right? It's a crazy world we live in. There's a lot going on right now. You might be scared. You might be sad. You might be wondering what to do. What does the Bible tell us to do? It tells us to lean on God. It tells us to go to him with our needs. Tells us to wait on him. So what if you're like, oh, but like this is happening tomorrow and I don't know what to do and blah, oh my goodness, what am I going to do? I need a plan, right? And God says, wait, trust me. It's hard to wait on someone, but I need to do something, right? Listen to what he said. He said, wait, let him show you what's going to happen. Let him do the work for you and he will make a way for you, right? But the Bible says it may not make sense to our people who are like, no, we got to do something, got to do something. Follow his instructions. He will bless you, right? All right, so let's pray together, guys. I want you to fold your hands, bow your head, close your eyes. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for teaching us through the story of Elisha and the three kings that whenever we have a need, we can trust you. We trust that you know us. We trust that you love us. We trust that you care about us and want to provide for us. Lord, we can come to you with our needs, and not only will you meet the needs we think of, you'll meet the needs we never thought to ask for. Father, just help us to always come to you with our needs, to be faithful and follow your instructions, to know that you won't ever let us down. And even if it doesn't make sense to us, it makes perfect sense to you, and you see things that we're never even going to know about. Father, help us to always trust in you no matter what. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Good job, you guys. It was great seeing you guys this week. It was great talking to you guys. I want to see you so badly. Please come back to service here on campus, 8:30, 10:30. I want to see you. But I understand, so if I don't, catch you guys here next week. Kids City Online. Bye.